Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulihil Kareem. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah alladhi arsala rasulahu bil huda wa dinil haq li yuzhirahu ala din kulli walau karihal mushrikun. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد يا أيها الحاضرين اتقوا الله اتقوا الله إن الله مع المتقين. Perhaps there is no other part of the Quran except Surah Al-Fatiha that is recited as often as the surah Qul Huwallahu Ahad, Allahu Samad, Lam Yalid, Walam Yulad, Walam Yakun Lahu Kufuwan Ahad. Today's khutbah, inshallah, is a brief commentary and just one word, Ahad. As we all know, the Quran cannot be translated, and I will explain how it is that one boxes oneself in the dynamic perceptual mapping when you go from one language to the other, from Arabic to English, or from the sacred language to a language that is not necessarily sacred. Sometimes the word Ahad is translated as one. No. And I'll demonstrate why it is only an approximation. Sometimes it's translated as unique. True, but not quite. It does not convey the meaning. Ahad stands on its own. And we'll illustrate our observations with reference to the life and times of one of the most influential people in human history, Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, Abraham. A figure that is honored by all of the Abrahamic traditions, the Jewish tradition, the Christian tradition, as well as the Islamic tradition. And we are honored with the presence of many non-Muslims here, influential people, and we follow the tradition of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who invited a delegation to Najran, which is in southern part of Arabia, to pray in the mosque of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abraham must be categorized as a scientist, as a sociologist, as a change agent, in addition to, of course, being the prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a Nabi, one of the most influential people in human history, because he changed the very concept of man. As we discussed in the last khutbah, Islam gave humankind a grand vision, a noble vision of its own self. And that grand vision derives from the contributions of Abraham. We'll take a slightly different way, different look at his history, a perhaps a scientific look, perhaps a rational look, and ask ourselves how what he did impacted human history and how it relates to the meaning of Ahad. Recall, Abraham was dissatisfied with the way things were around him. Humankind had become a prisoner of its own making. If someone asks you what is the greatest contribution of the Abrahamic traditions, It is that the Abrahamic traditions gave humankind a noble vision of itself and put man in the driver's seat in the cosmos, made man a responsible human being. It used to be that people used to feed their gods, give them milk, honey, whatever. Came Abraham, he changed all of that. The contribution of Abraham was to put man in the driver's seat in the cosmos, make him a responsible person, a responsible human being before God, before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was dissatisfied and he went through his intellectual struggles, his emotional struggles, his spiritual struggles by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because nothing happens except by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He saw that people were worshipping objects of their own making. If you worship an object of your own making, then you're subservient to that object. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us in the Quran, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. Not just أحسن, but أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ, the most beautiful of the molds. Humankind is the most beautiful of the beautiful, beautiful of the molds, the highest of the high. So when humankind worships objects of its own making, it becomes subservient to those objects. And Abraham asked himself, what does it mean? Who is my Lord? Who am I? These are fundamental questions that every human being sometime or the other asks himself or herself. Who am I? What is my purpose in life? Why am I here? What does it mean to say I worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that I worship God? These are fundamental questions that every human being asks himself. So Abraham also, Ibrahim alayhi salam also asked the questions. He was looking at light. He saw a star, a shining star in the heavens. And he said, like so many people of the age, oh, that is so distant, it's so beautiful, it is worthy of my worship. But then the star set, and he said to himself, that which sets is not worthy of my worship. And in here is a lesson for all of the people who deal with relational databases. There are so many IT engineers in here. Many of you deal with relational databases, or the physicists who study relations, or chemists, or indeed any discipline. Human perception is based upon relations. If there is no difference, then we do not have the capacity to know that. The thing in itself is not known to us. Whether we go the route of a physicist or a Sufi, you will ultimately come to the impasse. Whether it's the Heisenberg's principle or the thing in itself is not known to us, al-ism al-azam. We do not know the thing in itself. We know what is relational, what changes. Ibrahim alayhi salam looked at the star and said, it is not worthy of my worship because it has a relation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not have a relation. Keep thinking all the time during the khutbah about the meaning of ahad. One of the meanings of ahad is that it does not have any relationship. There is no relationship. Unique, yes. One, yes. But it does not quite communicate the power, the majesty, and the meaning of the word ahad. Then Ibrahim alayhi salam, he looked at the moon. It gave out more light. And he said, this is worthy of my worship, as did so many people of the age. And the moon set. And he said, it is not worthy of my worship, because that which sets has a relationship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no relationship. Qul hu Allahu ahad. No relationship. Then he looked at the sun in his grandeur and he said, ah, that is the most ebullient of them all and is certainly worthy of worship as did so many people of the age. And the son said, and Ibrahim alayhi salam, Abraham said to himself, Allah, I'm sick in my heart. If you do not guide me, I'll be amongst those who are lost. And he said, that is not worthy of our worship. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to the sun in his own heart, the light in his own heart. And he realized as a prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beyond any relationship. Ibrahim alayhi salam then communicates this message to the people around them. The people around them said, we don't believe you. We will follow the ways of our forefathers. We have these objects that we have built. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, like a rational human being, I'm trying to communicate one angle, only one aspect of the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. He was such a great man that one can take multiple views, different ways of looking at his great life, and come up with inferences and lessons for us to imbibe, inculcate, and practice. I'm looking at him as a rational person, as a scientific person. People said, no, we are going to follow the ways of our forefathers. He argues with his own father, and his father gets upset with him. Then he becomes a social activist. When nobody's looking, he goes into the temple, and some of the objects that they had built, he takes them down, except the largest object. And in the morning, people discover that most of the objects have been damaged, and they want to find out who did it. And people point to Ibrahim alayhi salam. They ask him, did you do it? Ibrahim alayhi salam says, ask the one, the largest one, the biggest one, that is still there. He will answer you because he's still intact. And people realized in their hearts that Ibrahim alayhi salam was telling the truth, but they could not face up to it. They could not rise up to the demands of the times. They got very upset and they said, build a big tower and throw him into the fire. Now whether we take fire literally or allegorically, it does not matter. The fire does not burn him. The fire gets cooled by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the same sense that if you're a truthful man, no matter what age, even today, if you're a truthful man, if you stand for the truth, you're bound to face difficulties. You're bound to face people who challenge you. But truth ultimately triumphs. That is the lesson of history. Untruth, falsehood, ultimately gets vanquished. That is the lesson of history. So the fire refuses to burn him. Here was a man who had arrived at the right conclusion by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, based upon relationships, that which is worthy of worship does not have a relationship. He was rejected, is thrown into the fire, and the fire refuses to burn him. Such was the contribution of Ibrahim alayhi salam. The worship of the unseen God, if you would, the God that you cannot conceive of. Some people will challenge you, and they will say, if you don't know God, if you don't have a personal God, how do you know Him? The answer is very clear. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us He has names. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran has 99 names. Each one of the names, you can write volumes, you can write oceans. How can you do justice to Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim? How can you do justice to Ghaffar and Ghafoor? How can you do justice to the name Al-Wadud, the loving, the kind, the graceful? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has names. And it's the beauty of Quranic language. A name has three attributes. First of all, it is a name. Secondly, it is an adjective. Thirdly, it's an adverb. Every Quranic word is derived from a mostly a trilateral word, which is a verb. The dynamics, it moves. And all the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are dynamic in as much as they influence all that we see, all that we experience, all that is around us, all that we call the cosmos. And that is only part of the universe as we know, because nowadays we realize there are billions of galaxies, and in each galaxy there are billions of stars, and we do not know how many worlds there are out there. We're trying to reach out to them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has names. We know Allah by His names, His attributes, and His adverbs. But what His attributes do, what His grace does, that's how we know Him. The thing in itself, Hu Allahu Ahad, we do not know. You see, I'll take a little digression and raise the following issue. Why was it that Iblis did not bow down to Adam? Adam alayhi salam was created, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala breathed into him of his own ruh, that is his own spirit, and he commanded the angels to bow down before him. Everybody bowed down except Iblis. He said, I'm not going to bow down before him. Why? Because he could not see the ruh inside of him. He said, he is made of clay and I'm made of fire. I'm made of energy. Well, these days, matter and energy are interchangeable, it does not matter, but until recently, you could see the thinking behind it. Now people say that Iblis was a muwahhid, that he believed in the Ahad, that there is no single particle in the universe on which the Iblis had not done his sajda, but he did not obey the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and therefore he was condemned. What I'm trying to communicate is that Ahad is a word that cannot be translated except that it becomes reflective. Hulhu Allahu Ahad. Then see what it does to a human being, a person, using the example of Ibrahim alayhi salam, how that idea, internalizing the Ahad, the unity, unicity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how he transforms an individual. Ibrahim alayhi salam goes with his wife in the direction of Mecca. There is no habitation. He leaves her there, praying, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, put mercy in the minds of some of the denizens of this land, those who live in this land, so that by your grace they feed my children some fruit. Now fruit doesn't quite mean fruit, it means other things, but it's a rough translation. And he leaves. Then Bibi Hajira is left to fend for herself. And she's looking for water, traverses between one hill and the other, Safa and Marwa, looking for water. By the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a stone splits up and the water springs forth from the rock. And Bibi Hajira cries out, Zumi ya Mubarak, stop, O blessed water. The lesson in here is that by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a heart as hard as a rock can open up, and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can spring forth from the heart. Never give up on an individual. One of the mistakes we make in correctional situations in modern age is that we give up on people too early, too soon. Never give up on a person. And never break the heart of a person, because the heart is the home of the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can break little small things. Never the heart of one which contains the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Ibrahim comes back, alayhi salam comes back the second time to build a house dedicated to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by this time, his son has grown up, and father and son stand together and build this house, the Kaaba, dedicated to what? To the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qul hu Allahu ahad, Allahu samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad, wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. And he has a vision. Ask yourself the transformation that comes upon a person when that person becomes subservient to, submits to, surrenders to that unicity. He has a vision to sacrifice his son. What does he do? Obeys. There is a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if a man looks for me, I look for him. If he walks one step towards me, I walk seven steps towards him. If he loves me, I love him even more. And when he loves me, he comes close to me. But then when he calls to me, I destroy him. It's a deep philosophical meaning. Destroying means the ego of the person. The person, the I-ness of the person is gone. And he becomes a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a servant of God, who serves all of his creation. A true servant, which is the true purpose of creation. مَا خَلَقُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسِ لَا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. But I created not beings of fire and beings of clay except to serve me. So Ibrahim alayhi salam is now a slave to the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He follows his vision. He asks his son, what is your will? His son says, Allah willing, you will find me agreeable. And the two of them proceed. And before the act is executed, comes the commandment, you have already fulfilled the vision. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want anybody's blood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want vengeance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want to cause harm to anyone. He loves everyone. Why else would he create? Ask yourself, if a mother could love a child, even when the child in the eyes of most people perhaps is not good looking, how much love does the mother have for the child? How much more love would be the creator of all humankind, of all universe? How much love would he have for each one of us? So much love that he makes us all unique, different. As I shared with you, never in the history of humankind will there be another person like you. Beautiful. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. Behold, I created you in the best of molds. He loves us. He does not want to cause harm to anyone. People spend so much time talking about hell. We should be talking about heaven. We should be talking about the gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. We should be talking about the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all humankind, and rise up to the challenge of becoming his servant, just as Abraham, the true, became a servant. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him so many titles. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls him an ummah of one, a word that is so often misunderstood. The word ummah means a spiritual station. From Adam alayhi salam to the time of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam comes each gradation of humankind, a spiritual evolution of man. If you want to study evolution, study spiritual evolution, because the material evolution statistically does not make sense. That's a different subject. So Ibrahim alayhi salam is called an ummah of one. There is one like him. He was the first one. He changed history. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to those who follow him as Ummate Ibrahim. Ummah. Millat. Millat means people, those who follow him. And all the prophets that came after him belong to his millat, including our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As is confirmed by the confirmed ahadith of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was a person unique by himself. He stood there at the apex of history, at the turn of history. That's another way. If you want to study history, if you want to understand the contributions of great prophets, of prophets, look for the bends in Islamic in history. dense in human history. But humankind messes it up, goes off on a tangent, comes the grace of God, intervenes the grace of God by the appearance of a great man, by the appearance of a prophet, by the appearance of a Rasul who corrects the situation and guides humankind in the right direction. Ibrahim alayhi salam stood at such an apex, at such a bend. He was the patriarch of patriarchs. He was the patriarch of prophets. He was the patriarch of all of the monotheistic faiths. He was an ummah of one. He was the first man, perhaps, who used the word Islam, that's another word that is misused, Muslim, misused, Muslim meaning one who surrenders himself to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not associated with rituals and a group of groups. It is a generic word. Here's a man who declared, Inni wajjahtu wajhiya lilladhi fatir as-samawati wal-ardi hanifan wama ana min al-mushrikeen. Indeed, wajjah. People translate wajjah to mean direction. No. Wajjah means existence. He says, indeed, I turn my existence towards the existence of one to whom is owed the primal origin of the heavens and the earth. How beautiful. He brought humankind to the right path. He brought humankind to the path of Islam in the generic sense. He brought Islam to the path of surrender. He brought Islam, he brought history to the path of service. Service Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to his word. So as the Hajj season we approach it, and so many of our brothers and sisters proceed for Hajj to visit the house that was built by Abraham, Ibrahim alayhi salam, and Ismail alayhi salam. Even as they visit them, we remember the life and times of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And we pray that all of our brothers and sisters who are going to Makkah and Medina, may their Hajj be a successful one. May they be safe.
Amen.
And may they come back with some of the barakah of the place and partake of the barakah with all of us. La hawla hawla hada wa astaghfirullah.
والسلام على رسوله الكريم إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد.
In this day and age, in a world that shrinks by the day, that is as far away as the blink of an eye, the speed of light, it is important, especially for our young people, to study the Quran, understand the inner meanings of it, to study the histories of the prophets, to study the histories that are referred to study nature and become scientists, understanding the limitations of each one of these disciplines in the context of Tawheed, that the thing in itself is unknowable. Science tells you relative truth. Sociology gives you relative truth. History teaches lessons, but relative lessons. Always know that reality is beyond it. It's important for our young people to study the Quran, to immerse themselves. They don't study. There is no reason not to study these days. Every person in America, every Muslim in America, if he understood the Quran correctly and acted upon it as the Prophet Ibrahim, He would become a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He would become a model, a role model for other people. He would become a good neighbor, a good member of society, a good citizen of the world, contributing. And yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise him or her to the highest of the high. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. Let us pray. Bismillahi rahman rahim. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وادخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار. يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين. اللهم انصرنا نصرا عزيزا وافتح لنا فتحا قريبا. اللهم اجعلنا من لدنك وليا. اللهم اجعلنا من لدنك سلطانا نصيرا. واكتب الصحة والسلامة والعفو والعافية والنصرة علينا وعلى الحجاج والزوار والوزار والمقيمين والمسافرين ببركة وبحرك وجعلك من أمة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم أجمعين وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء